couple days ago, I picked up the M2 Mac Mini and I compared it to my $13,000 Mac Pro. Today, I want to compare another device that I've been making a ton of content on. Based on the comments I got in that video, it seems a lot of people are out there comparing which chipset they should get, which device they should get for their DaVinci Resolve workflows. And so I just want to add one more kind of creative combination to show how these two devices compare. And because hard drive speed greatly impacts the performance of video editing, for both of these devices, the footage is actually on a Samsung T5 drive that we have directly plugged in. So now let's run through a series of tests and see how these devices perform. Now, no matter what device you are editing videos on, there's one thing that you need, and that is footage and assets. And you know who's got a lot of that? Today's sponsor, Storyblocks. Storyblocks has a ridiculously huge library of assets for stock footage, backgrounds, and templates. Easily filter down your parameters like 4K and the frame rate of your choice to find footage that will seamlessly fit into your existing projects. Now, I'm pretty stingy when it comes to using stock footage because I prefer to shoot my own stuff, but we've all been there where you're rushed on a set, you don't have time to get all of the like abstract B-roll that you'd hope for. So that's where being able to use insert shots from Storyblocks has been absolutely amazing. I love being able to find footage that is 4K ProRes, making it easily matchable to my existing cameras, allowing me to truly blend it into my existing work. So many stock footage platforms out there require you to do these a la carte systems that just become not only a little bit more confusing, but extremely expensive if you need more than a couple clips. And what happens if you buy a clip and then end up not using it in the final edit? You've just wasted money. With Storyblocks, there's no wasting money. Simply pick from an annual or monthly plan that works for you, giving you clear-cut licensing and pricing for all of your projects. Thanks, Storyblocks, for sponsoring today's video. The first test we're actually going to run is how fast the programs can start up. So first the M2 Mac Mini, and it'll be interesting because the other day in that video, it did it in about 25 seconds. 3, 2, 1. Wow, that was way faster than before. I was slow on the clicks. So 28 seconds to get the project open, but to be honest, the program opened so fast that I wasn't even ready to search for the project. So I'm gonna say that's pretty consistent. It was probably between 25 and 27 seconds actual. Very consistent with its previous performance. And this time for the iPad, but instead of opening to the database screen first, it just goes into the last project you were in. So we'll see if that's an advantage or disadvantage, I guess, if you're having to change projects. But since we're opening our last project, hopefully it should be an advantage. All right, so now for the iPad, 3, 2, 1. So 41 seconds. Again, shave off a couple seconds because I'm working upside down here, probably around 38 seconds or so, which actually is on par with my Intel Mac Pro. Again, this test doesn't matter as much because 10-ish seconds waiting for something to open isn't a huge deal in the grand scheme of things, but it is interesting to see. But honestly, I just like seeing how fast DaVinci Resolve opens up, because after years of being in Adobe Premiere, constantly wait for things to load, open, crash, and then open again, it's nice to see a program that just consistently and reliably opens. Okay, so now we've got both projects completely open. Both project settings are set to 4096 by 2160 4K timelines. Neither of them have any proxies or cached media. And on the Mac Mini, we are running at full resolution playback. And of course, on the iPad DaVinci Resolve, you don't even have the option to adjust that right now. So it's playing back at full res. Both these projects are roughly in the same spot. So I'm just gonna hit play and see how they play back. Again, I don't want to do any screen recordings because that greatly affects the performance of the playback as well as what you guys see in the final result. And so here on the Mac Mini, we can see that it's playing back pretty much real time. And although it does say the same thing on the iPad, it does seem to be lagging a bit more, although there we get into some graphic heavy moments, and the Mac Mini also struggles. They seem relatively on the same wavelength, where really simple clips that just have some basic color grading on it, it performs pretty well. But then as soon as you get to, like, this is a pretty serious comp put together, this has a lot of halation and open effects on it, it seems to be struggling quite a bit. So in general playback, they don't seem that different. I will say the M2 Mac Mini seems to be performing marginally better, which kind of makes sense because I've seen benchmarks on the M1 versus M2 iPad, and the M2 was about 10 to 15% better performance. And I kind of feel like that's what I'm seeing here. So it's just kind of that 10 to 15, maybe 20% marginally better performance on here for playback. Now let's go ahead and turn off the color grades and graphics. Let's go ahead and see how they play back now. And it looks like both of them are playing back in real time, real speed with no issues whatsoever. So this scene coming up again was shot at really high ISO, but because we have the open effects turned off, that also means the noise reduction's turned off. As soon as I turn those graphics back on and we try to play these back with noise reduction, you can see we're getting literally like 5 frames per second playback, showing about 5 frames on here as well. Pretty much identical, although the iPad seems to have fully stopped. So again, it looks like the M2 Mac Mini is performing marginally better. Definitely not perfect playback. I'd probably go down to quarter resolution. And so we can see at quarter resolution, it seems to be playing back nearly perfect. So even though this is twice the amount of RAM, the M1 chip and the graphics in it just really don't like playing back. Of course, this also is a lack of optimization for DaVinci Resolve for the iPad is my guess, but still, going quarter resolution on the M2, you can pretty much keep all your effects and color grades turned on, and it's playing back wonderfully. Now, another test that I did the other day was just kind of scrolling around the timelines, and sorry, I keep looking at my monitor since it's weird view. As we scroll around this timeline, how's the actual editing experience? And it's definitely not too bad. Scrolling around, I'm not noticing any lag. As I click to different areas in clips, they all load relatively quickly. And if I were to go to the end, let's say I had to add in new clips, open up one of my bins, obviously scrubbing the log footage we saw was a non-issue. And yeah, the editing experience on the M2 Mac Mini seems to be a really pleasant one. Scrolling around on here also seems to be pretty good. I mean, I can scrub with my finger here and I'm not noticing that much lag or delay. If I go to a new clip, it pretty much jumps right to it. And so that's really nice. Again, scrolling around the whole timeline, non-issues there. As learned on the iPad, you can pinch to zoom in and out of the timeline. That makes sense, but that's a really nice feature that I did not think about before. But yeah, dragging in those clips and working with that is a non-issue as well, making cuts. All the basic editing functionality seems to be really smooth on both of these systems. So one thing I didn't really talk about the performance of in my last video had to do with color grading. We saw the playback performance once you actually color graded something, but that's different than going through and actually color grading a clip and seeing if there's any lag or important issues to point out. So here I just have a new clip that we're working on both the same devices here. So I'm just gonna go ahead and add a few nodes as I normally do. And then I wanna start cycling through some LUTs. Normally I would just do a Rec 709 conversion. And then all I wanna do is kind of go through, see if there's any lag while scrolling through some LUTs. Scrubbing through the playhead seems perfectly normal. And so we'll find the one we need. We want Gen 5 to extended video, right on the second node there. We'll go in, make our corrections. Some scopes in there. I'll try reading the scopes via another monitor. And again, this is the 4K timeline. Now if I play this clip back, see we're still not having any issues. So now I wanna add a very fun plugin to play around with, which is built in right into DaVinci Resolve Studio, the face refinement tool. So I'm gonna add that on top of this node here. And I'm going to hit analyze. And you can see that it's instantly going to find her face and then track every frame. And you can see that it's doing it with relatively impressive speed and accuracy. You see that was what, like 10 seconds or something to keyframe the entire mask. Of course, now we can turn the overlay off. I'm gonna scrub to where we can see her face a bit more. And this is where you can go in and start refining. Now, for the sake of testing this out, I'm gonna push this a little beyond what you normally would. Add some contrast, brighten the face up a bit, color boost, get some of that shine out of there. Lips, we can actually change the hue. Just for convenience sake, let's give her some green lips. And add in some crazy blush. This looks ridiculous. I'm so sorry, Essie. So now let's see if we can play this back. Yeah, that's hurting it. We're rocking about 12 frames a second here. Now, since we're not getting perfect playback, but if I wanted to, it'd be as simple as going back to my edit page here, and I'm going to change my playback render cache to user. And then all I have to do is right click on this clip and render cache color output, and we'll see the little red line pop up right above. And this is where it can take a little bit to render this out. This is where you may want to work with proxies if you're doing a ton of this stuff. This actually is going surprisingly fast. If I make it a little bit bigger for you guys here. All right, so now it looks like it's completed. That probably took around 30 to 40 seconds. But now we can get our 24 FPS playback. And although that looks ridiculous, it also looks great. So now let's try to accomplish the same thing on the iPad and see how it performs. First thing I'm going to do is add some nodes. We're going to add the Rec. 709 conversion and then do a quick color balance. All right, so that's looking pretty solid. So now, believe it or not, this face refinement tool also exists on the iPad. And we can see our face refinement tool. And just like before, I'm just going to hit analyze and see the loading screen pop up. Honestly, this pretty much seems on par with the M2 Mac Mini. That's amazing to me, and it's already done. That may have been faster than the M2, to be honest. Kind of doing the same thing here, up the contrast slightly, a little brighter, get some shine out of there, and take the lips, make them green, and the blush, raise that saturation a bunch. Basically the same exact changes we made here, and check out our playback performance. It's sitting at 10 frames playback, so about 2 frames under the Mac Mini, basically on par with it. But again, if we go back to our edit page, and we go under our settings and then general options, so slightly different place. We can again change the render cache to user. Pick where you want to save it. I'm going to put it on the same hard drive. I'm going to hit save there, and then I'm going to again long press on this clip and render cache color output. All right, so now it's fully rendered out. Let's see if our playback's improved. And there we go, rendering out full speed, no issues whatsoever. So now for our final test, of course, is the export one. Having export times that take hours and hours long is incredibly frustrating because it ties up basically the entire computer since all of its resources are going to that, especially on lower end machines. This time I'm just gonna do a single export of a simple H.264 in the 4K timeline resolution. Everything else is set to normal. So who do you think is going to win in the export, the iPad or the Mac Mini? Let me know in the comments below. Let's start rendering these guys out. All right, the exports have finally finished, and it looks like the Mac Mini finished in 28 minutes and 32 seconds, and the iPad Pro finished in 33 minutes and 53 seconds. Honestly, they were a lot closer than I thought. I really thought the Mac Mini was going to be pretty significantly faster than the iPad Pro, but it really just shows that the M2 compared to the M1, this does have twice as much RAM, so that closes the gap, but it's maybe a 10 to 15% difference, very different than what we saw the other day with my Mac Pro. If you guys want to check that video out, make sure you check it out up here, and let me know down in the comments below what you thought of all these tests. Thanks so much for watching. See you in the next video.